Hello, hi everyone. Today we are starting with the first lesson on financial management paper. This is the paper of MBA second semester, and I'll be discussing with you the time value of money, and within that we'll discuss present value, future value, and many more concepts. Let us begin the lesson. The learning objective of this particular session are gaining knowledge on present value approach. That means how to calculate the present value, where all it can be applied, like in calculation of time value, a present value of money. The inverse of that can be used to calculate future value of money. Its application can be found in evaluating projects, new investment project, replacement of the old machine or something like that. Similarly, we can have many more applications like valuation of bond, valuation of equity, and certain other investment avenues. So with the help of this, we'll be able to understand the relationship between how yield to maturity and bond price are linked with each other. And there are many more applications which I shall discuss you as the class progresses. The four basic principles of finance are there. Money has a time value. A rupee received today is more or less valuable than a rupee received in the future. At times it may be more, or at times it may be less. Now, when it will be more and when it will be less, it depends upon the rate of interest, inflation, and the risk perception of the person who is calculating the time value of money. If rate of interest is positive, the present value is less than as compared to the future value. Whereas in many countries we see rate of interest is either zero or less than zero, that is negative. So when rate of interest is zero, present value and future value both have the same value. There is no difference between present value and the future value because you are earning no interest on that. Whereas when rate of interest is negative, it means present value will be higher as compared to the future value. And inverse will be applicable, that when rate of interest is positive, say 2%, 3%, or 5%, or till any number, the present value will be less. Say if you are going to receive 100 rupees after 1 year, its present value will be less than 100. And when rate of interest is negative and you are going to receive 100 rupees in future after 1 year, its present value will be more than 100. On the other hand, if rate of interest is zero, its present value will be the same as the future value. So if you are going to get, say, $100 or rupee 100 after 1 year, its present value will be the same. So that is the concept behind that, that a rupee received today is more or less valuable than a rupee received in future. So future value is always higher and present value is always lower whenever rate of interest is positive. Then there is a risk return trade-off. We only take risk when we expect to be compensated for the extra risk with additional return. And that is the normal human behavior, or investor who is a rational investor, he always expects a compensation for the risk. You will invest in risk-free avenue if you are not given good returns. Whereas the moment you are given extra premium, extra returns for assuming extra risk, you are likely to invest in risky avenue and leave the risk-free avenue. So it only depends how much you are compensated, what is your expectation, what is your risk-bearing capacity. And normally we say higher the risk, higher the return, and lower the risk, lower the return. That fundamental is also common, and it is applicable in everywhere in life, whether you are investing, whether you are saving the money, or even that is applicable in time also. Then we have the cash flow at the source of value. Profit is an accounting concept. Like, how do we arrive at the profit? From sales revenue, we deduct all the expenses. All expenses here means all the expenses which are cash expenses and non-cash expenses. Like non-cash expense, depreciation, amortization of different intangible assets, fictitious assets, and all those things are the non-cash expense. So arriving at profit requires deducting all the cash as well as non-cash expenses from sales revenue. Resulting value is first the profit before tax. The moment you apply the tax rate on the profit before tax, you'll get the taxable amount, tax payable amount. And after deducting tax payable amount from the profit before tax, you arrive at profit after tax. So that is the concept of profit. Now, to convert that profit into cash flow, what we need to do? We add back all the non-cash expenses which we have already deducted while arriving at the taxable amount. So idea is, cash flow simply means profit after tax plus all the non-cash expenses which have been deducted so far while arriving at the profit before tax. Then the next is market price reflects information. Investors respond to new information by buying and selling their investment. As soon as there is a new information like company might perform well, rate of interest might change, some pandemic like corona might spread, or some strike might take place in a company, all that information gets discounted in the prices. So that discounting mechanism is also based on time value of money. So there are many more principles which I'll be discussing with you in the coming lessons. Now, if we look at the time value of money, it has got two angles, present value and future value. And in this whole session, which might take four or five lessons respectively, one after another, I'll be discussing about present value, future value, application of that. We'll be doing n number of questions on that so that the concept will be more clear. And if you have any doubt, you can revert back to me. Now look at the fact, I have drawn a timeline over there. Zero period is today period, that is 0 year is today. And future period is 1 year or 2 year or 3 year. The line can continue till infinity. So present value is value today of a future cash flow. That means whatever future cash flow means inflow and outflow. It can be inflow or outflow. Inflow is with the positive sign and outflow is with the negative sign. Outflow means you're investing something, giving it to someone, or you're paying some money. Inflow means you're receiving it from someone. And future value is amount to which an investment will grow after earning an interest. Like in your junior classes or elementary or school classes, you might have studied about future value, which is compound value and interest factors also. So if you invest 100 rupees today and rate of interest is 10% per annum, simple compounding, then after 1 year, that 100 becomes 110. So that 110 is the future value of 100 invested at zero time. And that future value is realized after 1 year. So now we can link it. 110 after 1 year is equal to 100 today because your rate of interest is 10%. And vice versa is also true. If 100 is today, the present value, future value is 110. And if future value is 110, at the rate of 10%, its present value will be 100. In the subsequent slides, I'll be showing you how to calculate present value and future value. Let us proceed further. Now, this is a simple and compound interest fundamental which I have shown to you. Simple interest, if we calculate the future value, is equal to present value times 1 plus IT. I is the rate of interest and T is the applicable for the time duration. 1 year, 2 year, 3 year and something like that. So long as it is simple interest, you have to simply keep it I multiplied with T. But the moment you wish to take it to the compounding, then simply take out the T and raise it to the power of, so 1 plus I will be raised to the power of T. So that fundamental, when I explain the numerical, I'll explain. Deal with that one. So that is the compounding, like it may be monthly compounding, quarterly compounding, half yearly compounding and something like that. So we'll be dealing with the compounding frequency also. Then we have the continuous compounding. Continuous compounding means every moment compounding is taking place. So that goes for the exponential compounding, exponential function over there. So continuous compounding case will be the one in which we would have the future value is equal to present value times e raised to the power of it. I is the annual rate of interest and t is the time duration, like 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, whatever time duration you have kept for the investment. So herein what we are discussing here is only this So here you can see, we can proceed further next. The future value calculation example. If you invest 1,000 rupees at 10% interest rate, what is the future value in 2 years? So we can calculate if it is simple interest. So it will be in 2 years, simply 100 rupees annual interest times 2, it becomes 1000 plus 200, 1200. And that's the way it comes out. For first year, you earn the interest 100. And future value at the end of 1 year, it becomes 1100. Again, for second year, you earn the interest 100 and future value at the end of second year becomes 1200 rupees. Here you can see the simple interest. That means it is not a compound interest. We are not earning interest on interest. So whatever interest you earned in first year, it remains as it is. In second year, on that interest amount of first year, we don't earn any interest during the second year. If it is compounding, that is annual compounding, compounded once in a year, that means future value is equal to 1 plus I raised to the power of t. T will be 2 in this case. So future value will become 1210. So you can see if it is simple compounding, you earn less. Your 1000 becomes only 1200 after 1 year. And if it is compound interest, then certainly after 2 years, the 1000 becomes 1210. So you gain 10 extra by going through the mechanism of compounding. So different, I have shown it that on 100 rupees, you earn 10% extra, 10 rupees extra. Then if it is continuous compounding, so it will be 1000 times e raised to the power of 10% is 0.10, you know, percent means that value is being divided by 100 and multiplied by 2. So it becomes 1221.4. So you can compare it. Simple interest, you earn less. Compound interest, you earn more. And if it is continuous compounding, even you earn the more amount of that one. And that's what I've shown it. We can try it in our practice session also. If it is annual compounding, semi-annual compounding, and continuous compounding, and you can see how the graph moves, the interest earned. In annual compounding, it will be a little bit less. Semi-annual compounding, much more. Quarterly compounding, much more. Monthly compounding, much more. Daily compounding, much more. And if it is continuous compounding, you can see the curve. It goes like a steep curve as compared to not the step one. So now let us try some numericals on our worksheet. I'll share with you the Word document in which we can practice the fundamental of future value of money. Here, once again, I would like to remind it to you. We are discussing here only the future value of lump sum amount. So let me write over there for your clarity. And to have the more clear visibility of the lesson, let me increase the font size also to 14. And so you'll see it in 14th font size. So let us do it. Like future value of single flow of money. I hope you can visualize it comfortably. So the future value is there. FP is equal to PV times 1 plus I divided by M. That is simplified formula, I'm telling you. N times M. Now, what are these notions basically? So FP, all you know, in the previous slides, you have also seen. FV is equal to future value of money. PV is equal to present value of money, that is money invested today, or a single flow of money. I is the annual percentage rate of interest, that is 10% will be written in the formula as 0.10 and 5% as 0.05. Then N is the total duration of deposit, or we can say the time till which we want to be invested in. It will be years. M is basically compounding frequency in a year. for annual compounding. So let me put a table for you so that it becomes very handy for you whenever you are practicing at your end. Compounding, and this is the corresponding M value. If it is yearly, then M will be 1. If it is semi-annual, that is half yearly, M will be 2. And if it is quarterly, that is every 3 months. As you know, in banks we get it quarterly compounding. So there are 4 quarters in a year. So practically M is nothing but how many number of quarters are there in a year in this case. And then if it is monthly, that means every month. I hope you are getting the things. M will be 12. There will be 12 compoundings, or compounding will be done 12 times in a year. And let me put more thing also. Daily, that is 365 times in a year. So you can see that is the way. So M here, it will be small m. So now if we coin an example for that purpose, let us assume you deposit rupees 1000 at 0 time for a period of 5 years. If rate of interest is 12% annual percentage rate, then definitely we can work out on that one. So this is example 1. So if you go for the explanation of this, here our PV is equal to 1000. N is equal to 5 and M is 1 as it is annual compounding, 12% per annum. And let me put it over there, annual percentage rate. And if nothing is mentioned, it has to be by default annual compounding, as we have default functions in many places. Then I, which is equal to 10%, also 12%, or 0.12. Now let us apply the formula. F is equal to PV times 1 plus I raised to the power of N. Few people use N, few people use T, so it's up to you, but meaning has to be clear whether you use the T or N. T also means time duration, N also means time duration. So whatever way you do it, fundamental has to be clear. From book to book, from author to author, from teacher to teacher, notion or variables might change, but concept will never change. Keep that into mind. So here we will have 1000 times 1 plus 0.12 and then divided by 1. And then it is raised to the power of 5 times 1. So that makes it equal to 1000 multiplied with 1.12 raised to the power of 5. And we get it. If you do it, 1.12 raised to the power of 5, we get it an answer 1.7623. I have rounded it up to fourth decimal place. So 1.7623 times 1000, it becomes 1762.30 at the end of year 4. So that was the one example. Now we can have the another example. Taking the data of previous example, if compounding is half yearly, then find out future value. Rest all remains as it is. So now we can go for the explanation of that. Let me copy the basic facts so that we save up on the time. Class can progress much faster. Now here only one thing will change. M will become 2 because it is semi-annual compounding. What I need to do, I need to divide it by 2, I need to multiply it by 2, so I will get it 1.06 raised to the power of 10. That 10 basically means, now 10 does not remain the year, 10 is number of times it will be compounded during all the 5 years, in total duration of 5 years. So what is going to change over there? The rate has become half and time has become double. That is, time basically means number of times the compounding is done. So it will be simply 1.06 raised to the power of 10. So we get an answer 1.7908. Again rounded off to fourth decimal place. That is my normal practice, and that you must maintain it for intervening calculation. Final answer can be rounded off to two decimal places. So it will become Indian rupee 1079.80 at the end of year 5. And now again we can proceed further. Now you can see in annual compounding it was 1762.30, and in case of half yearly compounding it is 1790.80. So you can see the difference, how much extra interest you get as soon as compounding is done half yearly as compared to the yearly compounding. Now let us progress further. I hope you are getting the things, and if you have any doubt you can revert back to me. I'll give you sufficient time to ask your doubts and clarify the things. Now we taking the data of example number 1. If compounding is done quarterly, then find out the future value. Rest all remains as it is. So here only M will change. M will become 4 because there are 4 quarters in a year. That I hope is a simple logic. No one need to mug it up, but there are many people who start mugging up the table. Yearly compounding means 1, half yearly means 2, so that becomes a childish work. So please don't do that, apply the logic over there. So quarterly compounding. Here if we apply, we simply replace M with 4 at both the places. So we get a final version, 1.03 becomes, and raised to the power of 5/4, 20. So 1.03 raised to the power of 20. So you will get it 1.8061. So our answer changes now 1806.10. So you can see the difference. And let me try out one more thing for you, then we can make a comparative table for your purpose. That will look nice also in the presentation. Anywhere you are presenting in your presentation, like taking the data of example number one, if compounding is monthly, then M will become 12 only. So monthly compounding, and here I'll replace M in both the places. So we will get it 1% practically. So it means 1% per month you are earning. So it will be 60. So 1.01 raised to the power of 60. So that makes it again much larger value as compared to the earlier one which we received. 1.8167, I can see. So that hardly matters where do you round off, but mechanism has to be clear. So 1.8167 times 1000 makes it 1816.70 at the end of 5 years. Now we can have a comparative table. What all we tried? We tried 4 different types. And let me draw the table. Compounding. Present value is always the same, but future value will change. So compounding is annual, 1000 invested at time zero, and instead of present, because present value is supposed to remain the same, so we have duration. We can go for the count of n. M will be 1. There will be small m, remember. We will have the future value. Semi-annual, M will be 2. So if you do it, 1.12 raised to the power of 5, we did it, we multiplied it with 1000. So we can copy the answer from earlier one answer. 1.762.30, and then let me grab the data from top. It will become easy and save our time. So let me write down the data on my worksheet and then I'll type out here for you. So meantime, you can go through the things which we have discussed. Note down your doubts and then we'll discuss the doubts also. So it was 1762.30. Then we arrived at 1790.80, and then 1806.10, and for monthly it became 18167. So 18167. So it is 17. 90.80. Quarterly, M will be 4, and we will have the value 1806.10, and then we will have monthly. There will be 12 compoundings in a year, and we get 1816.70. So that is the way you can see a comparative table is there. Now, once we have understood the concept of future value of money, let us apply the same. This was the case with single flow of money. That means you invested once at zero time, and then you went in. Now we can take another example. We'll have example number 5. You plan to deposit following money in a bank account. So year 0, 1000, year 1, 2000, year 3, 3000, year 4, 5000, and year 5, 1000. So these are the money you will be investing in a bank account. Now here to remind you, for year 1 to 5, it is the end of the year you deposit the money. Rate of interest offered by bank is, we keep it, let us say 12%, and compounding may be in different manners. Like annual compounding, half yearly, quarterly, and then monthly. Now, if we go for the explanation of this, we will have, we can create a table that will make a very fast view and fast calculation. So I need column for the compounding and the formula and the future value, and we need 5 years. Compounding. Formula implication, then future value. The basic facts we already know. So in case of annual compounding, formula will be there. One raised to the power of 1, 2, 3 and other things. So accordingly it will be there. So we can sort it one by one, that will be more easy. So what we do, we draw a timeline there. If I take the timeline and deposit side by side, I need to find out the duration of these things, for how long the interest will be earned on that one. So duration matters. So we have year, it is 0, 1, 2, 3. And I need one more. 5. So I can take it on single page so that visibility is clear. You can understand it. So let us now move. So year of deposit. Once again, remind you for year 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, deposit is taking place at the end of the year. For zero, there is no beginning, no end, because both coincide at one place. So we have duration. So whatever you deposit at zero time, it goes for the 5 years. Like last value minus zero is equal to 5 years. Whatever you deposit at the end of first year, it will earn an interest for 4 years. Like you can count the in between gaps also for 4 years. Because first year until 5th year and 4 year it will become. Then we can have 5 minus 2. I hope you're getting the logic. 5 is the end when we need to find out how much I have accumulated in the bank account. Accumulated means the principal amount deposited by you plus the interest earned on that one. So it will be 5 minus 3, that is equal to 2. And then 5 minus 4, that is equal to 1. And lastly, it will be 5 minus 5, is equal to 0. So don't get surprised if it is 0. Because if you have just deposited the 5th year's amount and you wish to calculate the money. Then we have how the formula will work. Logic is there with you. In this case, it will be 1 plus 0.12 divided by 1, that is compounding frequency, and raised to the power of 5. So you will get how much amount you have deposited. So what I can do, I can shift this column of formula and put it what you are depositing over here. The same can be used in Excel also. Excel will make the calculation quick, but I'm afraid you will not be allowed Excel in your examination. So let us stick to the manual calculation using the calculator. Whether you are using simple calculator or scientific calculator, which is allowed in your examination. So please check the rules of the examination and your university before using the calculator. So amount deposited is 1000. So on this, you will earn the interest for 5 years. So if you multiply the outcome of this formula, 1.12 raised to the power of 5. So this multiplied by 1000. So it is 1762.30. So that is future value equals to principal amount plus interest earned. Then here I have not multiplied n with m because m is 1, so there is no fun in wasting time on multiplying again and again the same figures. So it will remain the same. Now what I need to do, I am depositing 2000 at the end of second year, where only hour will change to 4. So this is duration is basically, I have done it n times, it is n. And m is not required, so whenever we'll go to the quarterly compounding or subsequently, we'll go for that. So it will be 1.12 raised to the power of 4 times 2000. So that makes it 3147.04. So side by side, you can also verify the calculation. There's no difficulty. I hope the logic is clear by now. And if there is the slightest doubt, that can be cleared subsequently. As far as possible, I'll try. There is no doubt at the end of the class. However, nothing is denied. So you can contact me and we can revert back to the lesson whenever it is required for the doubt session. So then again, what we are depositing in the third year is 3000. So what I did first year, third year, fourth year and fifth year. So year 2 has not come. So let me put in the question also. Year 2 equals to 3000. So year 3 is again 3000. So year 3 again 3000. So whatever you are depositing in year 3, that will earn interest only for 2 years. 1.12 raised to the power of 2 multiplied by 3000. So that makes it 3763.20. Then year 4, you are depositing 5000. Now power will change to 1 only. 1.12 raised to the power of 1 makes it 1.12 only, and you have deposited 5000, that becomes 5600. And then we go to the last year when you are depositing 1000, but power will be 0. So anything raised to the power of 0 makes it 1. So it will remain 1000 as it is, as you have deposited. Now we can make a sum total of that, all the future value, and to look it more nice, I can go to the more justification on the right. The thing should look nice also when you are presenting. So it is total future value at the end of year 5. Sum it up. So that makes it 15724.12. Now you can see total deposited amount. You can total the deposited amount also. That is 3 and 3, 6, 9 and 10, 15000. So total deposited amount is equal to 15000. Future value is equal to 15724.12. Total interest earned in 5 years is the difference of these two values, 724.12. Now we can proceed the same thing. This was the explanation for annual compounding. We can proceed further if it is semi-annual compounding. So our basic facts, if I right there. In semi-annual compounding, what will happen? There is one more way. We can simply find out effective I is equal to annual percentage rate divided by M. So M is 2, so rate becomes 6. So that is a shortcut way, and effective T, let me say, it will be N times M. So in this case, 5 years times 2 is equal to 10. So in that case, we'll be using the formula. Future value is equal to present value. So it's still, it is lump sum amount. And I can say effective in rate. So you can give it a new name, EI. So it will be 1 plus EI raised to the power of T. So accordingly, what I need to do, instead of duration, what I'll do in this case, I'll calculate T. That effective duration, it becomes that is E. That was EI, effective interest rate. So effective duration is M times N. So it will be there 5 times 2 is equal to 10. It will be times 2 is equal to 8. I hope you're getting the things. It's much easier once you start practicing it. We see it is much handy, and we studied this in our junior classes. So always pay attention when your parents or teachers say remember the things, they might get used in life in any moment. So now you might be knowing that or realizing that yes, had you paid the attention in junior classes, you would have easily done it. Now I'll change this for EI. So life is a learning curve. Keep on learning every moment. Never forget whatever you learn in your life. So let us meantime pay attention on the things which I'm doing on the board also. With calculations you can do. And you can see effective EI is nothing but annual rate divided by compounding frequency. In this case, compounding frequency was 2. So accordingly, effective period also gets changed. Then we have 0.62, and I'll not be doing for you the quarterly part because quarterly you will be doing on your own. Monthly also you will be doing on your own. So far logic is clear with everyone. So let me replace the values 1.06 raised to the power of 10. So that makes it, now we can see the difference. Earlier it was 1762.30, and now things have changed. 1790.84, and remove these values and things will change. 1.06 raised to the power of 8 and times we have deposited 2000, so 1.06 raised to the power of 6 times 3000, that makes it 4255.56. Then we have 1.06 raised to the power of 4 and times 3000, so we get it 3787.43. And then 1.06 raised to the power of 2 times 5000, 5618.00, and this will remain as it is 1000 whatever. Now we can sum up the things: 1790.84, 3187.69, 4255.56. 3787.43, 5618, and 1000. So we get it 1790.84 plus 3187.69 plus 4255.56 plus 5618. Plus 15,852.09, and you can see the difference. I'll show you the earlier table. When it was annual compounding, we had 15,724.12, and now it has become 15,852. So interest earned changes, and that is the effect of compounding frequency. The more is the compounding frequency, more will be the interest. Less is the compounding frequency, less is the interest. And that's where when you go deposit the money in a bank, always pay the attention to the compounding frequency. That will make a difference. So that's all for the single flow of money and calculation of future value. Just to give a recap of the things, whenever you are calculating future value of money, always pay attention to the compounding frequency. You will have difference. It is very much observable. Compounding frequency is denoted as M in the formula. In case of annual, it will be 1. Semi-annual, it is 2. Quarterly, 4. Monthly, 12. So I hope that is clear. If you have any doubt, you can revert back to me. Thank you. Have a nice day.